Hello, I'm Kev Sheldrake. In 2010, Head Hacking started the annual hypnosis conference, Change Phenomena. In its second year, we were lucky enough to get Professor Irving Kirsch to come and speak. Irving's one of my biggest heroes. He dedicated his career to investigating hypnosis, suggestion, and placebo. He challenged beliefs and misconceptions. He tested the supposed facts. And certainly for us, he had a profound effect on the way we understand suggestion. This film was waited 8 years to be released. And to put it into context, I think it's one of the most important hypnosis lectures that you're ever going to see. So please sit back and enjoy the fantastic Professor Irving Kirsch. I introduce you to Irving Kirsch.
My intention is to leave some time for discussion between us at the end. Hopefully I'll raise some issues that you'll want to talk about. But first I want to introduce you to Dr. Zoe Katz, who is a diplomat of the American Psychotherapy Association, certified hypnotherapist by the International Medical and Dental Hypnotherapy Association, the National Guild of Hypnotists, and the American Board of Hypnotherapy. And now I'd like to show you a picture of Dr. Katz. Dr. Katz is in fact the pet cat of Steve Eichel, who I assume filled out the application for her. Which brings me to the first thing that I want to talk about, and that is ethics. Clearly, the organizations that provided those certificates to Dr. Katz for whatever amount of money they charged for it were not following good ethical principles. I want to talk about two particular ethical principles. The first derives from the fact that hypnosis is not, in and of itself, a treatment. It is an adjunct to some treatment. It's a procedure, a tool that can be used to enhance the effectiveness of various treatments. And because of that, and I will use a quote on this because it has never been said more eloquently than by Professor Martin Orn at Harvard University, the late Professor Orn at Harvard University, number of years ago, and he said, if a person is not professionally qualified to treat something without hypnosis, then they're not qualified to treat it with hypnosis either. First, you look for that professional certificate on the wall, physician, dentist, clinical psychologist, or whatever. Then you look for the certificate of hypnosis. Hopefully, the latter being from an organization that does take ethical training seriously. So that's the first ethical principle. And the second is that if you're going to practice, if you're going to use hypnosis in your practice, you need to know what works, and just as well, you need to know what does not work. And that should be based on scientific evidence, because we do have a scientific evidential base giving us guidelines as to what works and what doesn't. I'm going to begin this talk by summarizing some of the evidence we have for some of the things that don't work. I'll start with the bad news, and for some of the things that do work, I'll end with the good news. If you would like to learn more about the scientific base of hypnosis, there are a number of books, one of them that for some strange reason I happen to like, it's called The Essentials of Clinical Hypnosis, an Evidence-Based Approach. It was published by the American Psychological Association. So what does not work on the basis of coming to that conclusion on the basis of studies that try to verify that it did work and not succeeding? One, perhaps the most important one to be careful of, is memory recovery. through hypnosis. Memory is not like a video recording of an event. Memory is reconstructive. You have memory traces when you are asked to remember something, whether with hypnosis, without hypnosis. What happens is you search these memory traces, and they're always fragments, incomplete, and so you have to put them together with other things. This is an automatic, unconscious process, and you come up with something that will have accurate components and inaccurate components. And there's no way other than having factual outside evidence to know which is which. It's very easy to influence memory. You can influence memory by doing things like using misleading questions. Lawyers know how to do that in order to shape the testimony of witnesses. So if you say, "How fast was the car going when it crashed into the other car?" Or you ask, "How fast was the car going when it touched the other car?" You will get different, honest answers from your witness. The use of the term crash rather than touch or encounter leads people to remember, influence the way they remember the event. We know from research that age regression is not real. Age regression is a fantasy. You can regress somebody to an earlier age. They will have a fantasy of being an earlier age. The more suggestible a person is, I tend to prefer the term suggestible rather than hypnotizable for reasons I won't talk about at the moment. The more suggestible the person is, the more likely they're going to have a fantasy, the more vivid the fantasy will be, and the more likely they are to conclude that this fantasy is something that really happened, or in the case of future regression, something that will happen, that they're somehow magically remembering. Because of this, age regression can be very dangerous. Memory recovery work, in general, can be very dangerous. You can lead people, especially more suggestible people, into having memories, full-blown memories of events that have never happened. Not just changing the details of something that did happen, but full-blown events that never happened. There have been many court cases on this. There's also been quite a lot of research done. It is very clear that hypnosis does not enhance memory accuracy. It does have the potential for distorting memories. Second thing is the use of ideomotor signaling to communicate what is really there in the unconscious. Of course, it's very easy to get ideomotor movements with or without hypnosis. The person doesn't have to be very suggestible. About 80% of people are capable of having the experience of a hand moving, an arm moving, without experiencing themselves as doing it voluntarily. But there's absolutely no evidence. If you tell somebody, if the answer is yes, your left finger will lift into the air all by itself. The left finger raises, it doesn't tell you whether the answer in their subconscious is yes or no. It can raise for any number of reasons. It can raise because they've just heard the idea that the left finger will raise. Or it can raise because they have a fear that this might be true, a conscious fear, and that idea leads the finger to raise. You don't know what it means. Don't interpret it as evidence of what happens in the unconscious. And the third thing that does not work is neuro-linguistic programming. I used to believe in neuro-linguistic programming. When I first started doing research in hypnosis, I hate to tell you how many years ago, at the University of Connecticut, Bandler and Grinder's first works began coming out, Frogs into Princes, others. The first exposition of neuro-linguistic programming. And my colleagues in the clinical psychology program at the University of Connecticut and our graduate students, our doctoral students, and I got very excited. It seemed like such a reasonable, sensible approach. It seemed to offer a great shortcut to achieving some results and ways of increasing the efficacy of the therapy that we were doing. Being clinical psychologists in a university setting, we all also did research, and we began doing research on the various hypotheses that are part of neuro-linguistic programming. One of the hypotheses was that people have different representational styles. Some people are visualizers, some people are auditory, some people are tactile. You can judge these styles according to NLP in a number of ways. One way is by listening to the predicates that people use. A tactile person might say, "That feels right to me," whereas an auditory person would say, "I hear what you're saying," and a visual person might say, "I see what you mean." And you can also determine that, according to NLP, by looking at eye movements. What directions are the eyes moving in? And the other hypothesis is that if you match the language that you are using, visual, auditory, or kinesthetic, with the language that the client or patient is using, you're going to increase rapport. Well, we tested that. There is no relationship between eye movements and the predicates one uses, and there is no effect on rapport as a function of whether you match people's eye movements or don't, or match their predicates they habitually use or don't. It just has no effect. We tested the one session, single session treatment for phobias that are in the book Frogs into Princess, compared it to 1 hour of what is supposed to be a 5-hour course of cognitive behavior therapy. We found that the NLP 1-hour phobia session was significantly worse than just 1 hour of standard CBT. Then there was the double induction that was based on the, supposed to be based on the work of Milton Erickson. And in the double induction, you have two hypnotists, and one speaks into this ear and one speaks into that ear, and if you're speaking into the left ear, you're accessing the right side of the brain. If you speak into the right ear, you're accessing the left side of the brain, and this is supposed to be this powerful technique for inducing a deep trance in just about anybody. And we tested it. And I can tell you, the people who were doing the tests firmly believed in it. They were giving workshops, teaching people how to do these double inductions. And we compared it to a simple 5-minute relaxation-based audio taped induction, the simplest induction you can get. And again, the simple 5-minute audio taped induction was significantly better than the Bandler and Grinder double induction. So these are things that are still being taught, as far as I know. The research indicates they don't work. What does work? I'll spend more time on the good news. Hypnosis as an adjunct to psychotherapy works. Again, not as a standalone treatment, but as an adjunct. We did a meta-analysis. I should explain as simply as I can what a meta-analysis is. A meta-analysis is when you take, when there are a large number of studies have been done on some subject. In this case, what is the effect of adding hypnosis to a standard cognitive behavioral treatment? We looked through the literature. There were 18 studies at the time that had assessed that scientifically. And when you have a large number of studies, you do what's called a meta-analysis. It's just a statistical method of combining the results from a large number of studies so that you can reach a conclusion about what they're telling you if you put them all together, very commonly used. And we looked at how much benefit, how much better was the outcome of a standard cognitive behaviorally based psychotherapy treatment. How much better was it if it was bolstered by doing a hypnotic induction and using the word hypnosis? And here's what we find. These are what are called effect sizes. What I can tell you about them is that 0.3 is considered a small effect size, 0.5 is considered a moderate effect size, 0.8 is considered a large effect size. So we're talking about a very nice, large effect. And the thing that was strange when we first looked at these data was the fact that the effect was largest for physiological measures. Usually, when you do research on medical settings and psychotherapy, you get larger effects for self-report, somewhat smaller for behavior, and even smaller for physiology. We got just the opposite. We figured out why. Those 18 studies included six that measured, that you looked at hypnosis added to a weight loss program, a cognitive behaviorally based weight loss program. And here's what happened, lumping those studies together. Excuse me for using pounds rather than kilograms, but that's what we, America's still using pounds, what can I tell you? First place is where you see, is where before the treatment, right after treatment, you don't expect the result really quick because it takes time to lose weight. In fact, there's some evidence if you lose weight gradually, you'll have better luck keeping it off because you're doing it in a way that may be more sustainable. 1 to 2 months after the treatment, 4 to 6 months after the treatment, and finally a 2-year follow-up. And this was in the groups of people who received a weight loss program by a qualified therapist without hypnosis. And this is then being compared to people getting the exact same program, adding only the word hypnosis and the hypnotic induction. And here's what their weight loss data looked like. Most impressive gain is at the end of the 2-year follow-up, because with almost all weight loss programs, people tend to increase after they've lost their weight. People lose weight and then regain it. In at least these six studies, hypnosis helped people to keep the weight off once they had lost it. Hypnotic analgesia is probably the greatest success story of clinical hypnosis. It's correlated with suggestibility. So the more suggestible you are, the more likely you are to gain benefit from a pain control suggestion. About 75% of the population shows substantial relief from hypnotic suggestions to experience pain relief. It reduces the need for medication in post-operative patients. It's accompanied by changes in brain activity in areas that are part of what's called the pain matrix. And of course, the most spectacular that all of you know about is the ability to do surgery using only hypnosis and hypnotic suggestion as an anesthesia, something that's been known for approximately 150 years now. With all that being said, you might think, whoa, how great. Now all we have to do is learn how to put our people into a good trance, make sure we get the trance deep enough, and then we will be able to accomplish all these wonderful things. So what I need to talk about, again, based on scientific evidence, are the myths and then the realities of trance, something that will tie very neatly in, I think, with the theme of one of the later talks today, I gather from reading the titles in the program. Here's the general received wisdom, or perhaps received myth, of the hypnotic trance. The idea is that hypnotic inductions produce a trance state, and that the trance is necessary for someone to respond to suggestion, especially for the very difficult suggestion. Sure, people without being in any trance might be able to respond to something like arms moving together, feeling a force pulling their arms together, but certainly they wouldn't be able to tolerate surgery without being in the trance or hallucinate vividly. And there's the idea of trance depth. You can be in a lighter trance, a deeper trance, and the more difficult the suggestion, hallucinations being a very difficult suggestion, arm movement being a very easy suggestion, the more difficult the suggestion, the deeper the trance must be. There have been 7-8 studies now, going all the way back to 1933, and one of the more recent ones being this one in 1999, looking at what happens when you hypnotize somebody, give them some suggestions, versus what happens when you don't hypnotize them and you give them the same suggestions. All of the studies that have been done on it have come up with the exact same results, so I will just illustrate it with this one. And what we did in this one is we brought subjects in. There had been no mention of hypnosis at all. Absolutely zero mention of hypnosis. You know, you have to do informed consent. We did the informed consent twice, so that the first time we did it, we didn't have to mention hypnosis. And we said, we want to assess your ability to use your imagination to experience various things. Close your eyes, relax, and try to imagine the experiences that I will describe to you. And then we gave them a set of suggestions, of the type of suggestions that are used commonly in order to measure someone's hypnotic suggestibility. Suggestions for arm levitation, for some easy suggestions, some difficult suggestions. And then we said to them, now we'd like to repeat the same procedure, only this time we will use hypnosis. And we will first do a hypnotic induction so we can see how you experience suggestions, be able to compare how you experience with hypnosis to how you experience it without it. We did a standard hypnotic induction, and we gave the exact same suggestions. Now, you score these things by how many suggestions a person responds to behaviorally. You can also use experientially and so on. It doesn't matter in terms of what you get as an outcome. Most convenient to think about it in terms of behavioral responses to suggestion. And these are the number of people who either benefited, showed more, were more responsive in hypnosis than without hypnosis, versus those who got worse when you did a hypnotic induction, didn't respond as well. The modal response, the response shown by the largest number of participants, was zero. In other words, they did exactly the same whether you hypnotized or not. You might, at first glance, interpret this as suggesting that for many people, it doesn't make a difference. Some people are helped, some people are harmed by hypnosis. That would be a misinterpretation. The reason for that is if you give a set of suggestions twice, you can do it both times in hypnosis, you can do it both times without hypnosis, people are not going to respond identically the first time and the second time. Many will fail to respond one of those times to one of the suggestions that they respond to the other time, and it could be in the first or the second, it doesn't matter. You tend to get this normal curve. So here's what the effect really seems to be. What you'll notice is the negative side stays the same, and I just match it with the positive side. So this is what would happen if hypnosis made zero difference. If hypnosis made zero difference, basically these are just random changes balanced on both sides. What hypnosis actually does is give this, make this relatively small increment that winds up affecting 20% more or less of the population. So for 80% of the population, it won't make a difference whether you do an induction or not. For about 20%, you'll get somewhat of some benefit of varying sizes by having done the hypnotic induction. It's the reason, clinically, for most people, but not all, because some people can backfire, those that are afraid of hypnosis and so on, afraid of the idea of hypnosis. For most people, clinically, even knowing this, I continued to use hypnotic inductions. But what about difficult responses? What about things that people cannot control? Vivid hallucinations, pain reduction, even to the point of being able to tolerate surgery. Don't you need a hypnotic trance in order to experience changes that great, that drastic? Here are some data on that. And it starts with the Stroop effect. I don't expect that all of you know what the Stroop effect is. Perhaps some of you do. The Stroop effect works like this. Named after a fellow named Stroop, by the way. People are presented with words on a screen. And the words are printed in particular colors. And sometimes the meaning of the word is congruent with the color in which the word is printed. Those are called congruent trials. And sometimes it's incongruent, as here, when you have the word green printed in red letters. And sometimes they're neutral words, words that don't imply color, and they can be printed in any color at all. So there's no, it's not congruent, it's not incongruent. Now, the task that the person is given in a Stroop test like this is to, as quickly as possible, identify the color in which the word is printed, in which the letters are, the color of the letters. So in this case, it would be blue, green, black. I did that wrong. There's the Stroop effect. In this case, it would be blue, red, black. We throw away inaccurate trials. The question is, how quickly can they do it accurately? And you do get inaccurate trials as well. But here's what happens. You might guess people are much quicker at identifying the color when it is on, when it's congruent than when it is either incongruent or neutral. And the reason appears to be that having learned to read, reading is an automatic process. You cannot keep yourself. It's involuntary. It's not something you can voluntarily control. It keeps you from being able to quickly and efficiently identify the color. You're being influenced not just by the color of the letters, but also by the meaning of the word. Here's what we did. Give us the following suggestion to subjects. It's a post-hypnotic suggestion. When I clap my hands, meaningless symbols will appear in the middle of the screen. They will feel like characters of a foreign language that you do not know, and you will not attempt to attribute any meaning to them. That's a suggestion. We pre-select people for high levels of hypnotic suggestibility. We've done it with people with low levels as well. This does not work for them. So it has to be with highly suggestible people, because what we're asking them to do is to override an automatic process that they have learned as a child reading words. Here's what happens. This is the degree of reduction or increase in time that you get as a function of giving that suggestion. So this is the Stroop effect and how much it's reduced by giving the suggestion that I just read to you. And what you'll see is you get the significant reduction in the Stroop effect. You don't get it obliterated, but you get a big reduction in the Stroop effect when you give the suggestion to highly suggestible or highly hypnotizable people in hypnosis. You get the same thing if you do it without hypnosis. This is an ability that some people have that can be triggered by suggestion. It does not depend on going into a trance state. Altering color perception. Again, only works with highly, highly suggestible people. We show them this is the exact color pattern. We show them and we tell them this hypnotic suggestion is to drain all the color from it so that they see it only in shades of gray. Pretty tough suggestion to experience. And then we show them one in gray, shades of gray, and the suggestion is to add color to it so that they see it as if it were in full color. And sometimes we do this after hypnotizing them, and sometimes we do it without a hypnotic induction. Here's how much color they report seeing in it. They're looking now on this side at this fully colored pattern. Some of them have been hypnotized, some not. And they report color saturation of about 35-40% in or out of hypnosis. It doesn't matter. They are looking here on this side at this gray pattern, and they report 75-80% color saturation in or out of hypnosis. Are they telling us the truth? Are they really able to see color in a gray pattern, drain color from a color pattern? To find out, we put them in a MRI. We did an fMRI, magnetic resonance imaging. We imaged what happens in their brain when they are doing these tasks. And there's a lot of regions of the brain, and I could go through big charts on this, but I'm going to show you one particular area. It's the left fusiform. It's back here in the occipital lobe. And it's a part of the brain in which has been identified as being specific to color, seeing color. There's a left fusiform, there's a right fusiform. You have two halves to your brain. The right fusiform can be influenced by imagining color. The left fusiform is supposed to be specific to seeing rather than imagining color. We've got high suggestible subjects, we've got low suggestible subjects. Low suggestible subjects don't experience any changes at all. There's no change in the left fusiform. In the high suggestibles, what you get when they are adding color to a gray pattern is increased activity in this region of the brain that is associated with seeing color, the process of actually experiencing seeing color, and it happens bilaterally. It happens rather in both in hypnosis and without hypnosis. It also happens bilaterally, but I wanted to show you this because this is the one that's specific to the experience of seeing rather than just imagining color. Pain reduction. A study that one of my former students did, Len Millings, currently at the University of Hartford, where he's a professor of psychology. And he had a control group and a suggestion group, and for the control group, he just measured their pain three times using, he used a pain device. These were healthy volunteers, and he used a pain device that puts weight on the finger, and as the finger stays there, you keep it in for about 2 minutes, there's a cramping sensation and then greater and greater pain. He does it three times and doesn't do any intervention, so there isn't that much change in their pain ratings. And then he's got a suggestion group. By the way, these are people who are not picked for high levels of suggestibility. They're just taken off the street. They run the gamut in suggestibility. Tests their pain. gives them a suggestion for pain relief, that their finger is becoming numb as if it were injected by Novocaine, or I don't remember the exact wording of the suggestion he used, but something like that. Does a hypnotic induction, repeats the suggestion. Does it in and out of hypnosis. As you see, most of the effect comes from the suggestion itself, rather little of it from the hypnotic induction. There is a fellow in Valencia, Spain, by the name of Dr. Angel Escudero. He was filmed by the BBC in a documentary in which I was also filmed, which is how I first encountered his work. He does operations mostly for varicose veins. With suggestible people, he does so with no anesthetic whatsoever. They're wide awake. They have not been hypnotized. He doesn't use the word hypnosis. He doesn't do any kind of hypnotic induction. He suggests to them that just as they can produce saliva in their mouths by thinking about things, they can block the pain so that they don't feel it by thinking about things. And it's a lovely segment on the BBC with one of his patients being operated on, skin's open, surgeon's doing it, chatting with her. She's wide awake looking at herself in this mirror with a nice smile on her face. There she is. So, what is the hypnotic state? The hypnotic state seems to be something that can increase to a modest degree responsiveness to suggestion in maybe about 20% of people, but is not necessary for being able to experience the effects of suggestion. What is it? We did an fMRI analysis. What happens in the brain when you induce hypnosis and you're not giving any suggestion, you're just letting people rest, compared to letting the same people rest without having done the hypnotic suggestion? Low suggestibles have changes in activity in areas that are associated with relaxation, calmness. They experience the effects of the relaxation instructions in what we use as a very simple traditional relaxation-based induction. The high suggestibles show something else. They show a reduction in activity in what is called number of areas in the brain that's called the default mode. These are areas in the brain that are active when you're just sitting, doing nothing, daydreaming, letting your mind wander. They're areas that are usually reduced when you're engaged actively in some task, any kind of task at all. So as soon as you stop letting your mind wander and begin thinking about something, doing some kind of cognitive task, you get a reduction in the default mode. That's what happens to high suggestibles when you induce hypnosis. What they seem to be doing is engaging in the task of being hypnotized actively, whereas the lows are not. So you might think of hypnosis as a normal state of focused attention in which you are motivated and trying to do something. The responses that you get, whether you induce hypnosis first or not, are produced by motivation, the person's willingness, desire to have those experiences, their ability. There's a great degree of stability in suggestion. You can suggestibility. You can measure it over 25-year periods. You measure it in a group of people and wait 25 years and measure it again, and you get these very high correlations between how they behave the first time and how they behave the second time. So there seems to be some kind of ability, we don't know what produces and exactly what that ability is, that highly suggestible people have. It's influenced by people's beliefs and expectations, and there's a lot of data on that, I won't go into them for the moment, and by cognitive effort, doing something, deciding to, this is interesting, it's something I want to do, getting involved in it instead of just passively waiting for it to happen. The hypnotic induction is something that increases motivation, expectancy, and effort. Maybe I am going to go, well, I'll give you this data. I'll skip by this data. This is just correlations of responsiveness with fantasy proneness, motivation, and expectancy. And I'll skip by this one. No, I won't. This one's fun. Let me tell you this one. It's one of my favorite studies. It's a study that I did many years ago, 1989, as I recall. Does it say it on the thing? 1989. And it remains one of the most enjoyable studies that I did. We wanted to see what effect we could have on responsiveness to suggestion, to hypnotic suggestion, if we could convince people in advance that they were good hypnotic subjects. So here's what we did. We had one group of people, again, no testing, they'd never experienced hypnosis before, they had been screened just to determine that. Put them in this room, put them in a chair, and assess their hypnotic suggestibility and divided them into low suggestible, medium suggestible, high suggestible, depending on what their score was on a standard scale. That was the control group. With the experimental group, we brought them into the same room, sat them down in the same chair, did the same hypnotic induction, and then said to them, we inserted the following before assessing their suggestibility. We said, in a moment, I'm going to ask you to open your eyes. You can remain deeply hypnotized with your eyes wide open. Open your eyes. You may begin to notice something. The room is beginning to turn red. Little by little, turning redder and redder and redder. What they didn't know was behind them, there was a panel on hinges that we had oiled well so that it didn't squeak when you opened it. The experimenter opens this panel and there's a bank of lights. On the other side of the wall was Cynthia Wickless with her hands on these lights. And this one of the lights is a red light. And gradually she's turning it up. Gradually, 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 we piloted this very carefully. It had to be vivid enough so the person could see it, and yet subtle enough so that they could mistake it for their own internal imagination or experience. And then slowly turned it down. The red is fading, the room is returning to normal, but now it's beginning to turn blue. Bluer and bluer and bluer. Now the blue is fading and green. And now the room is beginning to flicker. And we had a white light that was on already, and it was on a rheostat also, and Cynthia was going like this with the white light. And then we had them close their eyes again. And then we give them the 12 suggestions that we use to assess hypnotic suggestibility. And that was the difference. 2 weeks later, we called them back because you have to debrief research participants. We showed them the panel of lights. We told them how we did it. We told them why we did it. And we asked if they would mind being hypnotized again. They all agreed. What do you think happened? Did they remain highly hypnotizable, or did they revert to being like the control subjects? Any guess? No, they didn't go back. They stayed high. That's what you would think, except for one thing. Why didn't they go back? When we assessed their suggestibility, we told them our hands getting heavier and all of that, we didn't enhance any of those suggestions by changing the environment at all. So now they knew from their own experience that they could experience these responses. We had taken the expectancy, belief-based barriers to their ability away, and even when we explained how we did it, they now knew that they had those abilities. They'd learned to ride the bicycle, and they could still ride it. So hypnosis is mostly suggestion, but suggestion is very powerful. And I want to talk for a little bit about the power of suggestion in the treatment of depression, which is what I've been occupying most of my time with for the past number of years. On the 26th of February in 2008, an article that I had published with some colleagues, some meta-analysis, now you know what meta-analyses are, of the effects of antidepressant drugs using data from the Food and Drug Administration that were sent to them by the pharmaceutical companies to get their drugs approved. A meta-analysis that we had done was published in the medical journal PLOS Medicine. That morning, I woke up to find that it was the lead front page story in most of the UK daily papers. Random House invited me to write a book about it, which is on the table in the back there, hint, hint. And the result was, 2 years later, a five-page cover story in Newsweek. Somehow, I had gone from being a mild-mannered university professor to being a media-hyped superhero or supervillain, depending it is, on whom it is you asked. What had we done, my colleagues and I? Most of the previous meta-analyses that had been done on antidepressants had been based on the published literature. That's how most meta-analyses are done. You do a computer search, you find out what's been published, you analyze it. The problem when it comes to depression, as we found out, is that 40% of the clinical trials conducted by the pharmaceutical companies on antidepressant drugs are just not published. The data are hidden. So we use the Freedom of Information Act to get from the Food and Drug Administration, which in the US licenses medications for the market. We got the FDA files on what at that time were the six most widely prescribed antidepressant drugs. Having the published, unpublished trials as well as the published trials turned out to be critical, because here's the way the thing works. If you look at only the published literature, which is all that people had available to them before, about three quarters of the clinical trials show a significant difference between the antidepressant and a placebo. If you look at the unpublished trials that for some strange reason, the pharmaceutical companies didn't want to send out to journals, 88% of them show no difference at all. We looked, combined them all, we looked at the published and the unpublished studies. Depression, for regulatory purposes, up until this year, and that's another story, but I don't know if we'll have time to get into it, up until this year, depression for regulatory purposes are all measured on a scale called the Hamilton rating scale for depression. In the drug condition, you got, on average, across about 40 clinical trials, 10-point improvement on the Hamilton scale. The Hamilton scale is a 17-item scale with scores ranging from 0 to 51. It's a reasonable, clinically meaningful average improvement. In the placebo group, you got about 8.35, I believe. The difference was like this. If you think of the drug effect as being the difference between what you get on placebo and what you get on drug, that's what's added by the chemical, that's 18% of the response to antidepressants. The placebo response was 82%. The mean difference on the Hamilton scale is 1.8. Why is that important? What does 1.8 mean? NICE, you all know what NICE is. When I give this talk in America, I have to explain to the National Institute of Health and Clinical Excellence that sets treatment guidelines for the National Health Service. Establishes as a criterion for clinical significance of an antidepressant, there has to be, they say, at least a 3-point difference between the effects of the drug and the effects of the placebo on the Hamilton scale. These antidepressants don't come close. Now, I said clinically significant, and this is something you have to, that I have to explain. There's a difference between clinical significance and statistical significance, and I want to briefly explain what that is. Statistical significance has to do with whether an effect is real or just due to chance. What would happen if you did the study again? Clinical significance has to do with how large the effect is. Let's take an example. Imagine that a study on 500,000 people finds that smiling increases life expectancy by 10 seconds. With 500,000 subjects, that is going to be statistically significant, I guarantee it. But it's not clinically meaningful at all. So we're talking about how meaningful is the difference that you get. Some people said, well, maybe they're not effective for mildly depressed, but certainly they're very effective for severely depressed people. So we went back to the data and we looked at how much of a difference there was based on level of depression. That red bar, that's the clinical, that's the bar it has to pass in order to be, for a difference to be clinically meaningful. We found one trial of moderately depressed patients in the FDA data, had no effect at all. None of the trials were on severely depressed patients. All of the rest of them were on very severely depressed patients. That's the most severe category of depression that is used in both the NICE and the American Psychiatric Association classification scheme. Well below clinical significance, we found only one group of people, a small group of studies, on extremely, extremely severely depressed, mostly hospitalized patients who crossed that bar, who crossed that bar. What percentage of the population? About 10%. 90% of the patients to whom antidepressants are being prescribed today are not having a clinically meaningful benefit from the drugs that are being prescribed to them. So how should depression be treated? One possibility is just plain, simple physical exercise. Comes off very well compared to anything in the research literature. Here's my favorite study, in which they looked at the percent of people who were no longer depressed. Remission is a hard criteria to meet, as a function of having been in an exercise program and continuing their exercise, having been given an SSRI, antidepressant drugs, or being put in an exercise program and given antidepressant drugs. Remission rates, 70% in the exercise group, 50% in the antidepressant group, and also in the exercise plus antidepressant group. Somehow the antidepressant seems to have cut into, lower the effectiveness of the exercise program. Perhaps we should, I should point out the effects of exercise. We don't know how it works, why we know it works, we don't know why or how. Maybe it's a placebo. But if it is a placebo, consider the difference between the side effects of antidepressants. Here are some of the more frequent ones, plus increased risk of suicide in children and young adults, increased risk of ovarian and breast cancer, withdrawal symptoms in about 20 to 50% of patients who try to get off of that, and compare that to the side effects of physical exercise. Increased libido, longer life expectancy, better muscle tone, better sleep. Which placebo would you rather have? So exercise is one possibility. Psychotherapy is another. In particular, the psychotherapy that's been most tested is cognitive behavior therapy. In the short run, it's no better or worse than antidepressant drugs. Produces a meaningful effect. Over the long run, it really has an advantage. Here's a comparison of treatment just by drugs compared to patients who were given 10 sessions of CBT. The drug patients were given 10 sessions of clinical management. They got the same amount of time and attention by a therapist. The CBT patients had added to that 10 weeks, the specific techniques that are used in cognitive behavior therapy. Relapse rates in patients as a function of these two conditions at 2 years and at 6 years. And what you'll notice in both points, cognitive behavior therapy, 10 sessions drastically reduces the risk of relapsing and becoming depressed again. And the effects of CBT, as I showed you earlier, is enhanced by hypnosis, generally, across the board for most types of treatments for which it's been studied. Now, there might arguably be some side effects to hypnosis, but I don't think we have to worry about them too much. Still, what got me into this whole area of research of antidepressants wasn't really an interest in antidepressants, it was an interest in placebos. I've been interested in placebos my whole academic life, been studying placebos, placebo effect. We can't prescribe placebos to our patients because that would be deceptive, and we can't lie to patients. I really believe we shouldn't lie to patients. But I wish we could. They're effective. Their effects can be long-lasting. They're not addictive. They have very few side effects. And so I imagine that someday I'll get up in the morning and I'll open my morning newspaper, and I'll find that the FDA has approved the use of prescription placebo in doses ranging up to 40,000 milligrams. And then I figure if we can prescribe placebos, we can also advertise them. And I wondered, what would a placebo advertisement look like? I imagine it would look something like this. Prevaricaine, a genuine placebo medication, tested in more clinical trials than any other treatment. So powerful, it's the standard by which all other medications are treated. So effective, it's used in the treatment of thousands of ailments. Safe enough to be given to infants, the elderly, and pregnant women. Remember, if it's a placebo, you can believe in it. Thank you. Do we have about 5 minutes? That's right. So I'd be happy to take questions or comments.
Yeah, just ask the question. So in your mind, is hypnosis a state or just placebo?
Well, is it a state or just placebo? I don't think it's a placebo. To the extent that it's a state, depends on how you want to talk about the term state. Charles Tart, who was one of the people who did the most work years and years ago on altered states of consciousness, was careful to say, when you use the state, don't use the term just to mean a transitory change. We mean something profoundly different. In that sense, it is not a state. It is a socially constructed, cultural phenomenon, something that we can define in terms of particular settings within particular cultures, and it does impact the way people experience. Not to a great degree, the hypnotic induction percent per se, but to some extent. And that does seem to be linked to some changes that take place in the brain. But the changes that take place in the brain are not massive, they're very subtle. And what they just seem to indicate is that somebody's paying attention and not letting their mind wander and engaging themselves in the experience of what's going on. If you want to call that a state, then it is a state.
You said you announced things that don't work, that have been proven to not work. When you said NLP and the ideomotor response, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, obviously not just in this room, but all over the world, you've got people that have studied NLP for years and years and years, and therapists who set up an ideomotor response to get signals from the subconscious. It's not really a question, it's just a statement. I just found that fascinating. And they will, you know, attest to having phenomenal results either by the use of NLP or the ideomotor response. I just found that it was a bold statement to make.
Yeah, one of the things that you might be interested in knowing is, although in the 1970s and 80s, there was tremendous interest in NLP among clinical psychologists in the US, and that's what led to being studied and researched, that has all but disappeared. It's hard to find a university-based clinical psychologist who takes it seriously anymore, because all of the research studies have come out negative. There's not been one. There was one particularly nice thing about NLP, at least as it was formulated in the early days, and that is that it very clearly generated testable hypotheses. It was easy to study. That was one of its attractions and one of its advantages. The problem is that all the data turned out to be negative. Yeah?
Just help me out here to understand your point, because at the beginning you spent quite a lot of time showing how hypnosis does not have an effect really to how people respond to suggestions. And I thought, well, you give people full-blown arm levitations, hand locks, amnesia, whatever it is you actually tested, and from there you conclude they've not been hypnotized. Just because you haven't given them an induction. So what then is hypnosis for you? Because I personally think if somebody produces all these phenomena, they are in at least what you call a normal, very focused state of attention.
Yeah, there's a way of defining hypnosis that makes it all hypnosis, but still the induction or the change of general background state becomes not completely irrelevant, but close to it. That is, hypnosis can be defined as a large domain of events that involves most clearly the administration of particular types of suggestion. I call them imaginative suggestion. In earlier years, it was called primary suggestion. Prestige suggestion is an even earlier, so more than 100 years old, that term for it. Suggestions to experience something that the person knows is not being produced by the external environment. In that which case, you can then talk about, as some people have, waking hypnosis versus trance hypnosis. And sure, then, yes, hypnosis, all of that is hypnosis, and hypnosis works. And hypnosis can have large effects. Trance is, first of all, a misnomer. Second, the hypnotic state, that is some kind of background general state independent of response and suggestion, plays a relatively small role. It's the suggestion that is producing the effect. Good. Thank you very much.